Good morning, everyone. You're very welcome as we gather together to worship the Lord, who is worthy of our praise, of our adoration. A letter from the Good News for Everyone organization, just a thank you note for the offering that went from one of our evening services sometime back, £335, to the work of the local branch. And thanks to those who contributed to that, and continue to remember the work of Good News for Everyone in your prayers. In regard to last Sunday evening, the offering over at the Thanksgiving service in Ramon came to £529 to date, and that'll be forwarded on to Stephen and Angelina Cowan and that the ministry that they're involved in Northern Kenya. Tomorrow evening, committee meeting at 8 in the Minor Hall here, the Congregational Committee. Prior to that, 7:30, if the elders can meet in the room just behind me here, that would be great. So if Kirk Session could meet at 7:30 tomorrow evening, and then committee meeting at 8 in the Minor Hall. The midweek meeting on Wednesday, 8 p.m. in the Minor Hall, we're continuing studies in the Lord's Prayer as the Lord guides us how to pray through that great prayer, and studying God's Word and meeting together to pray Wednesday at 8. Thursday of this week, and please notice Thursday night, the children's choir practice in preparation for Children's Day, 6:45 to 7:30, the same time, 6:45 to 7:30, but on Thursday evening this week. And Children's Day will be the first Sunday in June, the 2nd of June. And then this Friday, the Girls Association continues 6:30 to 8 over in Ramon Hall this week, and that's for those primary one up to age 16. But remember, it's over in Ramon this coming Friday. And we're thankful for the start that was made last week here in the hall, and for those that helped and support and uphold it all in prayer. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 115, the opening three verses. And the psalmist said, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory. For the sake of your steadfast love and your faithfulness, why should the nations say, 'Where is their God?' Our God is in the heavens, and he does all that he pleases." And so, as the psalmist had that concern for the glory of the name of the Lord, not for his own glory, but for the glory of the name of the Lord, so as we gather here to worship the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may our concern be for the glory of his great name. He rules over all. He's the sovereign Lord, and he does whatever he pleases. He's the sovereign Lord. And so we want to lift high his precious name. We're going to sing God's praise, our opening praise. We're singing Psalm 100, "All people that on earth do dwell," and then, "Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus." Let us worship God. We'll stand to sing.
Thank you.
Let's come to God in prayer. Let us unite our hearts. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, may it be that we taste more and more of the depth of your love for us in Jesus. O Lord Jesus, may we realize how great is that love. We pray for that work of God, the Holy Spirit, in our midst, to open the eyes of our heart, to flood your love afresh into our lives. O Lord, even as the Apostle said in Romans 5, to shed your love abroad in our hearts by the power of the Holy Spirit, that we might rejoice in you, that we might know the joy of your nearness and your salvation. Thank you, Lord, that you love us, even though you know all about us. How great is your patience and your mercy toward us. We thank you that this good news and this call of the gospel is for all the nations, all people that on earth do dwell. Sing to the Lord. Lord, we pray that song of praise to you, the living God, would come into our hearts this day, even for the first time, young and older alike, that the joy of praising the living God would thrill our hearts. You have made us for yourself, Lord, and we don't find our reason for living until we come to know you and your redeeming grace. Thank you, O God, that in your great mercy you grab hold of the wayward and the rebellious. Long before we ever thought of you, Lord, you reached out and grabbed hold of us. And you lifted us out of the miry clay, and you set our feet upon a rock. And you granted to us the gift of faith in Jesus as we heard the gospel. You granted us that mercy of hearing the gospel. And for some, it came to us all of a sudden, like somebody stumbling over the greatest treasure they could ever find. And for others, they'd been searching and longing for years to find peace with God, and eventually they realized that they needed to lay the burden down, to stop striving to be good and to trust in the goodness of Jesus. Oh, Father, we thank you for the way you deal with us, each one as individuals. We're not clones to you, Lord. You know every detail about us. And we thank you, Lord, for your gracious hand upon us all the days of our lives. How great is your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for seed time and harvest. We thank you, Lord, for favorable weather, even in these past weeks, for people to be able to get on with the work that needed to be done and for seeds to be planted. And already we see growth coming forth, Lord. We're amazed at just the wonder of it all. And Lord, as a seed is planted into the ground and dies to bring forth life, so, Lord, we realize the seed of your word planted into us, Lord, brings forth life. And our Lord Jesus died so that life would come from his death and glorious resurrection. We thank you for the power of new birth and the power of new hearts that love you. And we thank you, Lord, and pray that we might see more and more the evidence of growth. Growth as you make your face to shine upon us, as you pour out your blessings upon us, as your word comes to us like refreshing rain or dew on the grass, so may your word come to us this day and refresh and revive our hearts in your great love. Forgive us our many sins, Lord. Forgive us a lack of love for others, a lack of care for those around about us with no thought of you. Forgive us, Lord, our busyness, for often, Lord, we're far too busy. And busy with things that aren't that important. And forgive us, Lord, when we neglect our duties, whether to family or to church. Lord, our duty to you in our individual walk. Grant that that duty or all those duties would become more and more a delight to us, that we delight to do the things you call us to do. Lord, pour out your Spirit upon us and open our understanding in our ears, that we might worship you aright, in Jesus' name. Amen. We turn to Genesis 3 and then to 1 Corinthians 11. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1, the well-known account of the fall of mankind into sin. Genesis 3 and verse 1, let us hear God's word. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God, among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? And he said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat? The man said, the woman whom you gave to me with me, she gave me fruit of the tree, and I ate. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. And the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. And that's verse 15, is the first prophecy of our Lord Jesus Christ coming to defeat the evil one, the offspring of the woman. And every birth from here on in, they're wondering, is this the one? Is this the Messiah? Is this the promised one who's going to come and defeat the evil one? And it's Jesus who fulfills this. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. To the woman, he said, verse 16, I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing, and pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be contrary to your husband, but he shall rule over you. And to Adam, he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife, and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, and for you are dust, and to dust you shall return. The man called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. And the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skins and clothed them. Then the Lord God said, behold, the man has become like one of us in knowing good and evil. Now lest he reach out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him out from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden he placed the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. Then turning to 1 Corinthians 11, and we read verses 2 to 16 of 1 Corinthians 11. After the Gospels and Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians 11, verse 2 to 16, the Apostle Paul wrote by the Spirit of God, now I commend you because you remember me in everything and maintain the traditions even as I delivered them to you. But I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. Every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head, but every wife who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head, since it is the same as if her head were shaven. For if a wife will not cover her head, then she should cut her hair short. But since it is disgraceful for a wife to cut off her hair or shave her head, let her cover her head. For a man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God. but woman is the glory of man. For man was not made from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. That is why a wife ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man nor man of woman. For as woman was made from man, so man is now born of woman, and all things are from God. Judge for yourselves, is it proper for a wife to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not nature itself teach you that if a man wears long hair, it is a disgrace for him? But if a woman has long hair, it is her glory, for her hair is given to her for a covering. If anyone is inclined to be contentious, we have no such practice, nor do the churches of God. Amen, and we thank God for these readings from his precious word. If the girls and boys come to the front for a few moments, please. Good morning, and good to see you all. Thank you for coming forward. Tell me, in the Bible story we read, or the first one we read from Genesis, you remember the name of the first man and the first woman? Those are two easy questions. The name of the first man? Yes? Eve. First woman's Eve, and the first man's?
Adam.
Adam and Eve. Very good. You're doing well. And they were in the garden, and everything was perfect for a little while. Everything was perfect for a little while. And then something terrible happened. And do you remember how the story goes? God had placed them there and given them everything they needed and more for life and godliness. And there was one tree they weren't allowed to eat of, tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But who came along and said to the woman, just go ahead and eat? Who came along?
A snake
or a serpent. And it was Satan, the devil, the evil one, in the form of a serpent, came along, told them, God really won't, you won't really die. No bad will come to you if you eat of it. And who ate first? And who was right there beside her?
Adam.
And both of them should have known better. And they both ate. They both ate the fruit, and they felt their shame and their guilt. They knew when, do you ever get found out when you've done something you shouldn't have done? Now, just take it for granted, you do things you shouldn't do. Because when Adam sinned, all of us are affected. Every human life after Adam and Eve were born with a sinful nature, and nobody had to teach you or me how to sin and do the wrong thing. It all came naturally because we all now sin with that sinful nature. But they knew they'd done something wrong. Same way when you do something wrong, you're thinking, you're looking around thinking, I wonder did anybody see me? And they knew they'd done something wrong, and they tried to cover over their shame. They made clothes for themselves out of fig leaves, trying to cover over their shame. And then God came near to them again, as God walked with them in the garden. That's the language we hear. It's the closeness of God with Adam and Eve. And God calls out, Adam, where are you? Now, it wasn't because God didn't know where Adam was, right? God knows all things. God knew what had happened. But for Adam's benefit and for Eve's benefit, God asked, where are you? And God's coming in mercy and calling to Adam, where are you? And you know what they did? They hid. They tried to hide from God. They should have known better, but they tried to hide from God. But there was no hiding from God. And then God asked them, what had they done? And you know what happens next? They all blame somebody. When you do something wrong, you'd sometimes blame somebody else, wouldn't you? The blame game started with Adam and Eve. And you notice, next slide maybe it is, on ahead one. What have you done? God's asking. Who's Adam pointing at? He's pointing at Eve. He's blaming Eve. This woman you put here with me, she ate and then I ate. And who's Eve pointing at? She's pointing at the serpent or Satan. She's saying, he tricked me. And we all like to blame somebody when we do something wrong, instead of saying, Lord, I've done something wrong and I need to be forgiven. But God was very patient and kind with Adam and Eve, just as he is with you and me. And God provided, even though death did come, and Adam and Eve would eventually die physically, spiritual death had come, but God comes with mercy. And he provides them a different covering. not the garments made out of leaves, but out of animal skins. So an animal died in the place of Adam and Eve. The blood of the animal was shed so that they could live. And they're clothed now in these robes. And the robes we're clothed in are not animal skins. It's the robes of Jesus cover us over. Just as God provided for Adam and Eve forgiveness, he has provided the royal robes of Jesus, his righteousness, to cover us over. But there was a consequence to their sin, and they were put out of the Garden of Eden. And there were angels guarding the way back into the garden. They had a flaming sword there. And you read in Revelation of these angels and the way to the tree of life. And they were put out. There was a consequence to their sin, and there was pain, and there was suffering now in the world. And yet the mercy of God still comes, and God still brings salvation to all who will believe in his precious Son. Adam and Eve and sin entering into the world. And blame, we all like to blame someone. We need to say, Lord, I'm guilty. I have sinned, and I need you to forgive me and to take away my sin. Cover me over. Give me your royal robes, the robes of Jesus, his perfect life covering mine. We're going to sing of that reality of salvation. It starts with the letter S, sin. It is a dreadful thing. Thank you. That was one of the Children's Day songs last year, wasn't it, that you taught us? And a great one to remember. And we look forward to Children's Day this year as well. I didn't mention in regard to last Sunday evening that there's an audio recording, a basic recording, that's now available on the Ramon Facebook page of that service. And hopefully it'll be clear enough for you to be able to follow on with. You don't need to be a Facebook user to access it. It's an open page, so you can click on that and listen to the audio, or let others that weren't able to get there listen to that audio of the service with Deborah singing and Sam interviewed and preaching, Sam Mowinney, last Sunday evening. We continue to worship God as we bring our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
you to choir and to Audrey in her prayers of intercession, among others. We remember the outreach has taken place over the weekend at the Northwest, and for all who gather there, that the light of the gospel would shine, and for the incoming week in Balmoral, and the witness of good news for everyone, the witness of her own denomination at the show as well, and for others that will be seeking to spread the gospel. We pray for that move of God's Spirit. Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for every opportunity you give to us to share the good news of Jesus with others. Thank you that you open up conversations. Thank you, Lord, for what you have opened up for us even in the past week. And we pray, Lord, that opening of ears to hear as conversations take place, that ears would be opened and hearts changed, and a response to the gospel, a positive response would come. And thank you, Lord, for the many that maybe already have heard in the Northwest over this weekend, have been meeting with friends that have spoken to them about you, or come across Christian groups of one form or another seeking to reach out with the gospel. And Father, we pray for those leaflets that have been taken, that they'll not be all trampled on, but that many will be read, and the light of the gospel will change lives. We pray, Father, for the salvation of souls. Thank you, Lord, even this past week for a conversation with a dear soul, Lord, who some years ago at such a gathering of many people in a nearby town was spoken to by a group witnessing, and she drew alongside and listened to them and called upon the name of Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for just the wonder of your timing and the wonder of your hand of mercy to grant someone that had grown up under the sound of your word an urgency to get right with you and to be saved by your grace. So, Lord, grant that urgency even today and in the week that lies ahead. Even at the show, Lord, we pray in the busyness there that many will take time to step aside and to enter into conversation with those that are speaking of you. And Father, we pray that you will change lives, Lord, transform hearts, encourage those that are downcast, and grant life everlasting to those that are dead in their sin. Father, we pray for your mercy. Give wisdom to those that reach out, Lord, to help them to know what to say and how to listen. And grant, O God, that move of your gracious Spirit. Our Father in heaven, as we gather here this day, we pray, Lord, for those not able to gather with us. We name to you loved ones in hospital or nursing homes or being cared for at home in their different situations. And we name to you not only them, Lord, but those that care for them. Grant them help and strength and love as they go about their work, and wisdom and all the treatment that they give. For those awaiting the outcome of test results or those going through treatment, Lord, may your hand of mercy strengthen them and encourage them. Grant them hope renewed this day in your good purpose in all things. And grant them to see, Lord, your hand at work even this very minute, to cast all their cares upon you and to know that you're caring for them. Bless their witness to those around about them, to a new mission field maybe that you've brought them to, and to people in great need of your help and your salvation. So bless loved ones, Lord, that know and love you and are sure of their salvation. Grant them, God, that enabling to look beyond themselves, even in their trials and their troubles, to see the needs of others around about them. And for loved ones, Lord, who lack any clarity in your gospel, they're feeling their brokenness and their frailty of body, soul, or mind, Lord, and they have no peace or assurance that they're saved. Lord, grant them to see just the simplicity and the beauty of your gospel, and grant that they would have an urgency to get right with you. Lord, bring that urgency into all our hearts, an urgency in the things eternal and the things that really matter. For we get so caught up at times with the fleeting things, the temporal things. Father, we pray your ongoing blessing upon the work among our children and young people in our Sunday school and children's church in preparation for Children's Day services and for the Girls Association. And we thank you for your hand upon it all and for all the teachers and leaders you raise up, for your safekeeping for us, Lord. We pray continue to bless and to mold and shape lives. Help with the preparations for SISM teams around the area here, for outreach teams and those that will go on them. We pray, Lord, burden hearts to pray and to intercede for the spread of the gospel. Lord, we pray your wisdom for session committee. We pray, lead and guide and make clear your will and your way for the days that lie ahead. We pray, Father, that we would use all that you have given us wisely for your glory. We continue to pray for Sam Mawinney and his wife Karen, that you'll encourage them in these remaining weeks of that time aside from congregational life and involved in so many other congregations. And with the beginning of General Assembly and duties there, grant your help. And for Richard and Lynn and the family and for the congregation of Durmrea, we pray, Lord, for your help as they prepare for what lies ahead in that role of the Richard as moderator. We ask for your hand of mercy upon them and grant them liberty to speak of the wonder of Jesus. Father, feed us with your word and guide us in your truth. And we pray, Lord, for the Kyans there and others serving overseas, that as these gifts go to them or to Good News for Everyone or to Faith Mission, these different gifts and offerings, Lord, may they be encouraged in their work and to know that people are praying for them and supporting and upholding what they do. So bless their ministries, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I think it was 2002, but I'm not just so sure of the year, when the Queen Mother, the late Queen Mother, died, and her funeral became the topic of conversation, a royal funeral. And one of the things that was being discussed and debated was, would it be the normal royal protocol, as it had been, that for those attending the royal funeral, the woman would wear hats or some sort of head covering? And I think it was the directive from the palace on that occasion, with the Queen Mother's death, that the hats were not compulsory. You can look it up and search it out. One aspect of the reality of head coverings of one kind or another being debated in our present day culture. Another is, of course, for those of the Muslim religion and for some groupings within that, where the woman will wear the hijab and all that you will see in public will be the little bit around the eyes revealed. And so all sorts of contemporary context, the matter of head coverings is discussed and debated, and in our province and within our churches it's sometimes debated and talked about. Well, 1 Corinthians 11 is the passage, and really the only passage probably that specifically relates to the issue of head covering. Now, there are other passages in the New Testament that deal with the roles of male and female clearly, but as to the whole issue of head covering in particular, 1 Corinthians 11. And if you remember the background to the letter, the Corinthians, Paul had been there 18 months, Acts 18. He had ministered there and taught on as the gospel gripped lives and people were saved and the church established and growing. And then they send a letter to him, or maybe more than one. They write to him with their questions. And there seems to be another reply came back at one letter. At least we have two letters to Corinth, and there may be another missing that we don't have. But he writes back with answers, guiding their specific questions and issues. And if I had the option to write to Paul and ask him questions as the Corinthians did, one of the questions I had been asking him to write to me back about and to explain to me, give me more information as to what you mean in 1 Corinthians 11. I would like to know more detail as to what's meant by all of this, because it's not straightforward to translate. The Greek is difficult to translate in places, and it's not straightforward to understand. Now, all scripture is precious, God-breathed, and some of the inclination would come to a passage like this and say that's divisive and not necessary and we'll just pass over it. And maybe years ago I might have thought like that, but I'm not allowed to think like that by God. It's all his word. And so we work our way through the scriptures and we don't just pick up the things we like or find easy. As the Apostle Peter said in regard to some of Paul's writings, they're difficult to understand. And 1 Corinthians 11 in the opening section here, 2 to 16, has some difficult bits for us to understand, or at least for my wee mind to understand. Your mind may cope with it a whole lot better. Looking at it this morning under the issue of honor or glory and headship, honor and headship. And these are the key themes that flow out of it and are understandable. And first thing to say is that God's order of things and God's design, he makes us different by design. And so there's a difference between male and female. Now that may seem to be stating the obvious, but it needs to be stated. And the distinction between male and female, God ordained, God by design making us different, needs to be stated. And the goodness of both and the need for both. And in our contemporary world with so many identity issues, and every human heart has identity issues. So don't be thinking identity issues, that's just some few people out there or maybe a growing group of people out there. Every heart has identity issues. And until our identity is securely in Christ, we will have major identity issues. And when we come to know Jesus and we realize that our identity is in him and we're his and he is ours and we're Christ's, oh, he brings peace to our hearts. And as to who we are as people, he brings clarity for us. And so we're different by design in terms of male and female and the different aspects of our humanity that are drawn out, and even in 1 Corinthians 11. We're different by design, God's good design. And we care for those who struggle with identity issues of one kind or another, and those who think themselves great when all the time they should be thinking themselves in a humble way. We pray and care for everyone, because everyone needs their identity to be found and rooted in Jesus Christ if they're to have peace. But different by design, male and female. Secondly, a difference by design does not mean inequality between male and female. We are equally human and equally made in the image of God, and our catechism reinforces that, and other passages in Corinthians we've touched on reinforce it in the scriptures. God made man and woman in his image, in the image of God. He made them male and female, Genesis. This reality of equality and yet different roles. And we see that taught even in 1 Corinthians 11 in verse 3. Reading verse 2, and I might glance between NIV, the 1984 one here that's before me, and the ESV, and you'll notice the differences. If you're following on, you'll notice the differences in translations and meanings that are brought out by our translators. Incidentally, if you're following on in the King James, or if you're referring later to the King James to try to get a grip of another translation and what it brings out, the words in italics very helpfully in the King James are the translators acknowledging we have added these in. These are words added in to fill out the meaning or try to help you mean. It seeks to be a literal word-for-word translation, but an exact word-for-word translation is impossible from one language to another. If you've ever tried to translate something, you know that, because in one language, one word will have a layer of meanings, possible meanings. Then you translate that into another language, and in that language, the word you translated into may have a range of meanings. So quite easily, people can misunderstand. Even when you think you get the words right, people can take a different meaning from the word. So the difficulty of translation, we should not underestimate. And thank God that we have the scriptures in our language, in the plain language of the people, as the Westminster Confession desired and longed for, that the scriptures should be in the plain or the vulgar language, the plain language of the people of the day. And that was the Reformers' desire, to always translate the scriptures into the language of the day and the time so that people can understand. And so in verse 2, Paul says, I commend you because you remember me in everything and maintain the traditions even as I delivered them to you. I don't miss that. He's commending them. They're seeking to imitate him as he imitates Christ, verse 1, chapter 11. But he's saying, these traditions I passed on, I received them. I received them, and the implication is from the Lord, and I passed on to you. And he goes on to say that in regard to the Lord's Supper. What he received, he passed on. He wasn't trying to invent anything. He's passing on the truth. And the Lord commissioning Paul as an apostle, especially to the Gentiles, with the truth. And so this reality of equality, I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ, verse 3. The head of a wife or a woman is is the man or her husband. The ESV translates here wife and husband in place of woman and man in other translations, and both are possible. The word for woman can mean wife depending on the context. So they have made a statement as to their understanding when they translated wife. And the head of Christ is God. And so there's this distinction in roles. When we say the head of Christ is God, we're not speaking of some inequality between God the Father and God the Son. While the Father is the head of Christ, and there's this willing subordination in terms of role, and the Son comes to serve and to fulfill the will of the Father, the Son is eternally God. He's one with the Father and the Holy Spirit, truly God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, truly God. So we're not saying there's any inequality in the Godhead when we speak of this difference of roles. And so when we speak of difference of roles for male and female within family, within church, it's not about inequality. Far from it. Male and female equal in creation, made in the image of God, equally fallen, equally sinful. We fell with Adam in that first sin, guilty, as the head of the human race, and we all are impacted with this. Nobody had to teach you or me how to sin. Equal in redemption, redeemed by the blood of Christ. When we come to trust in Jesus, there's this equality in the family of God as to our identity in Christ. And so don't be in any doubt of that. And the preciousness of every human life and every Christian life we seek to uphold and to declare. Thirdly then, well, there's the difference by design, and there's the equality, there is dependence or interdependence. And so while Paul speaks much here of the order of things, now some will debate the meaning of the word head. Is it referring to authority, or is it referring to source and the origin of things, as in the head of a river or a little spring somewhere in a mountain? Is it about source or is it authority? And I'm not sure that the debate is that helpful, because it's probably both in reality. But certainly in terms of authority, in terms of Christ submitting to the will and authority of the Father, the issue of authority is there, of responsibility, of different roles. And so people can get into all sorts of debates about it all. And the issue of head covering there is some expression of all of this, and the difference in roles is what's in the debate. Nevertheless, verse 11, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor man of woman. While the man came first, as Paul outlines in the preceding verses, and Eve was made from the man, yet men all come from a mother now, is the emphasis. So this reality, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor man of woman. For as woman was made from man, so man is now born of woman, and all things are from God. So it's God who rules over all, and we depend upon one another. God made Adam first, and Adam needed help. And all the women here know that men need help, and the men, we're slower to realize that we need help. And sometimes we get our eyes open and we realize we need help every hour of every day, and we humble ourselves to acknowledge that we need help. And we are dependent on one another, interdependent, and ultimately dependent on God, for all things come from God. All things are from God. And so there's this interdependence, whether in home life, whether in church life and society, there's this interdependence of male and female, but ultimately upon God. And then fourthly, this passage is relating to worship and the unity of the fellowship of God's people. And that's the context here. I want you to understand verse 3. And he says all of this in regard to difference of order, speaking about good order. That's the whole flow of these next chapters. It's about good order within the church. The head of every man is Christ. Christ is the head of the church. He's the head of every man. He's the one who rules over us. The head of a wife, her husband, and the head of Christ is God. And so there's this order. And it's in the context of worship when we come together and do things in a way that is orderly. Now, the Holy Spirit brings freedom and spontaneity as we worship the Lord and we're prompted by the Spirit, and some fellowships as they meet will be full of spontaneity and people getting up and bringing their words. And I've been part of fellowships like that with friends over the years, going to their place of worship and student days or since, and learning from the way they might do things. And there are all sorts of pros and cons of every form of worship, and even the most, those that think themselves the most spontaneous have their set form. And I imagine if you went to a Quaker fellowship today, the Society of Friends, and they wait in silence for the Spirit to move them before somebody could get up and speak, I imagine it'll be pretty set as to who'll get up and speak. That most places have their set form and way of doing things. And even in the more charismatic fellowships that think it's all very free and Spirit-led, the Spirit of God brings order. As in creation, the Spirit of God brought order, so the Spirit of God brings order into the worship of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So we do not see order as something contrary to the Spirit, but we still need the Spirit of God to breathe life into our worship. If it's just going through a ritual or a pattern of things without any work of the Spirit, it is all empty, just religion. But the Spirit of God brings order. And the context here is about praying and prophesying. It's about worship. And notably, the thing that might be missed in 1 Corinthians 11 is it's referring to a woman in the fellowship praying and prophesying. Verse 4 says, every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head. Now, is that referring to his own head or to Christ as his head? And all these questions I would like to ask the apostle one day. But every wife who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head. Again, is that her own literal head or her husband? Since it is the same as if her head were shaven. And so it's the context there of praying and prophesying in the fellowship. And some people in their understanding of all this would think that if they're going to get up as a woman and lead in prayer or prophecy in terms of bringing some sort of word or message from the Lord, then they need their head covered in that context. So all sorts of debates flow. But it is the context of men and women praying and prophesying, opening up the word and rejoicing in God and pouring out their hearts to Him. That's the context of worship, and the context of seeking to maintain the unity of the fellowship. And that's something that's difficult, to maintain the unity of the fellowship. And there needs to be good order for unity to be maintained. And some people who don't like order probably end up going and starting another fellowship down the road or in the town or whatever. And that has happened countless times. That is usually over some minor issue or secondary doctrine. Not often is it over really the central issues, the things that we cannot disagree on. But such is life in a fallen world, and the reality of the unity of the fellowship and the worship of God is precious. And so we long for that unity, that people will unite around Christ and humbly want to serve Christ. And that's what really is coming through here in terms of honor and headship. It's about humility. Humility of men in their roles, whether within family or church, humility of women in their roles in family and church, a humility under the headship of Christ. He's the sole king and head of the church. And the whole issue of what responsibilities men are to take up within church life, the big problem throughout the centuries in the present day is the problem of the laziness of men. Slow to serve, to humbly serve Christ and His church. Not for our egos or our names or our ends, but for the glory of Jesus. And when men lead in a Christ-like manner and follow after Christ leading and serving the one who is the servant king, you'll see churches begin to flourish. And women will gladly serve alongside such men in seeking to use their gifts for the honor and the glory of Jesus. And so when people distort male headship into some sort of dictatorial bossing people around, like some commander sitting in a base somewhere and never actually in action anywhere. It's a total distortion of what it ought to be. It's about serving. And so fifthly, I'd say distinguish. We have different by design, we have equality, we have dependence, and it's about worship and the unity of the fellowship. Fifthly, distinguish between that which is a creation pattern or a cultural practice. Now, all too quickly, people can read New Testament passages and say that's all cultural. That was back then in first century Corinth. That doesn't really apply now. And we can throw a lot of things out dangerously. And the key issue here of the difference of roles and the distinction and the harmony and order that is to be maintained in the fellowship is central. This issue of headship is central. The head covering or the long hair, whichever it is the bit that maybe is cultural, and I think is cultural in this context. So I'm not too quick to say of difficult passages in Scripture, that's cultural, therefore it doesn't matter anymore. There are creation principles here in terms of the order of creation, and they stand for all time. And so the difference of roles for male and female, that's something that goes back to creation. What went wrong in the garden? Adam was not giving the lead that he should have been giving. He was right there, right beside Eve when she was deceived and ate of that fruit, and he was right there, Genesis tells us. And he's meant to be caring for her and protecting her and leading. And he said nothing. And he partook along with her. And it's the failure of men to give the lead that they're meant to give. And that's the creation pattern. And so the cultural aspect of things, and why I think there's a cultural aspect to what Paul speaks about in head coverings here, and it could be that the head covering is just long hair, or it could be that the head covering is some sort of covering of the head. I don't think of the face, but covering of the head. And both have been argued for, and I can see the point in that reality of both arguments. But I think there's something cultural here as to what was happening in Corinth and the surrounding churches, because he says this is the practice of all the churches here at the time. Why do I think it's cultural? Because of other passages in the Old Testament Scripture that speak in regard to head covering and length of hair, or even the Jewish practice. Now, I looked this morning, couldn't find it. It'll probably turn up when I go home, or maybe it's in the bin. But some years ago, I had the privilege of being in Israel, and at part of it, we went to Jerusalem, and we were able to go to a sacred site for the Jews, the Wailing Wall, the place where they put all those little prayer requests in between the stones and where they weep and they cry to God. And nearby you see the mosque or the dome of it, and it's contested territory like no other. And if the like of me as a Gentile is to go and get near the Wailing Wall, what was I given? I was given a little skull cap to put on, a head covering. So the Jewish context and background and Jewish synagogue worship and the early church's pattern flows out of the synagogues. Context was Jewish men wearing a head covering, so it wasn't to their shame to wear a head covering. So I'm slightly perturbed. I'd be asking Paul, explain all this to me. I'd be saying, Paul, what about the Nazarite vow? I think Paul even took it on one occasion. What about the Nazarite vow? You think of a man with long hair in Scripture, and it wasn't his shame, it was his glory. Who was it? Samson. It was his strength. And what's long and what's short in terms of hair length for men or for women? I don't know the answer to that. Some of us don't have much worry about it, but I don't know the answer to that. So there are a lot of questions I'd be asking. What does it all mean? But all those things, is it a shame for a woman whose hair is short because of illness or treatment or one thing or another that she might feel some sort of reluctance to come into the fellowship of the Lord's people? Not at all. I pray not, if she's able and well enough to come, that she comes and joins with us. Our identity is in Christ, not in the length of our hair. God looks on the heart, not the outer appearance. And yet the outer appearance is to be modest, a sign of humility. And in the cultural context of Corinth, it seems this head covering thing indicated something of that modesty and that humility and that acknowledgement of the distinction of roles. That's my understanding of it. So finally, last point, whatever might be your view on all of this, respect those with different opinions on it all. Those who open up Corinthians 11 and are persuaded that they ought to wear a head covering. That's perfectly understandable. Reading 1 Corinthians 11, and many would come to that conclusion. And if that be the conclusion you come to, then you ought to wear it. Respect your own conscience. When you go against your own conscience, you sin. When your conscience is telling you from the scripture that you ought to wear some sort of head covering in the fellowship, and you don't do it, then you sin. So respect your own conscience and respect those with different of opinion. But there are many things I don't understand, and I wouldn't say I fully understand all the arguments that are going on in 1 Corinthians 11, and even the translating of some of the words or verses is difficult. The bit about the angels. Verse 10, that is why a wife, verse 9, neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. That is why a wife ought to have a symbol of authority on her head, because of the angels. Another verse that you wonder, Paul, explain a bit more. But why a wife ought to have, the word symbol, if your modern translation had italics, the symbol bit wouldn't be there. That is why a wife ought to have authority on her head. And it could well be that she takes authority of her own head as to her own life and the decisions she makes here. So there's different ways of translating verse 10 very legitimately. All I would say is I'm not quite clear what Paul is referring to there. So some things are easier to understand than others, and we do well to acknowledge that when we turn to the scriptures. But the flow of honor and headship and equality and interdependence and worship, all of those things flow out of this passage. There's more than enough here to feed our souls any day of the week. And the other bits we don't understand as clearly. We do well to agree to disagree on and respect those that come to different conclusions. It wouldn't be an issue in some fellowships. The issue of a head covering is a matter of whether or not you can become a member. So if you don't follow a certain pattern and all of that, then you could not be a full member of some fellowships. I don't think this is something that should be made into that issue, but that's my own personal view. If people are persuaded of their line from the scriptures, then obviously they will think it's an essential. I'm old enough to have grown up on a day when I think in my home church probably most of the older woman would have been wearing a head covering of one form or another. And such are the things that intrigue you when you're sitting there as a child growing up. The dear lady and her husband who sat in front of us, and some days you struggle to see past the head covering out of the pew, but so there was a hairpin in the back of the hair, and that hairpin intrigued us as lads and I suppose my sisters too, and you just thought, I'd love to get a hold of that thing. It was like a lethal weapon. So probably should be a risk assessment with things like that nowadays, but the things that just stick in your memory. But that was the practice and the culture of the time, and cultures move on and change, but creation patterns don't change. And humble hearts seeking to worship God and to use the gifts God has given for the glory of his name. That's, to me, the key things that flow out of this passage. Good order in the worship of God for the glory of his name. We'll sing together, you servants of God. Let's pray together. Dear Father in heaven, grant us that desire for the glory of your holy name. Grant us that unity as we worship week by week. Grant us, O Lord, to continue to know your nearness. Gather others from the surrounding area in around your word to rejoice in you. O Lord, grant us to know how to do all things in a way that brings glory to your name. Grant us humble hearts, hearts that long for the honor of your name and the good of others. And may we see each one, men and women and children growing up, using the gifts and abilities you've given for the glory and honor of your name. Part us with your blessing and strengthen us in your service for the week that lies ahead. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.